Welcome to Dice Junkies, and this is Random Encounters, episode 26. Oh man, I'm out of mana. I'm here with
Q,
Damien,
and I'm Xenodamus. Hope you enjoy. All right, so let's start it up. Random Encounters. All right, so I'm going to roll first. Let's see what we get here.
Three
is DJ Cuisine Part 3. Oh, wow. What do we got on the menu?
All right, we've discussed, beer and cheese, and then we discussed your
grilling down on those burgers.
And the grilling.
Sausage. And
how about your sausage-making skills, man? There you go.
Alcohol-based cooking.
Oh, yeah, alcohol-based cooking.
With the brats, like the brats I just did, man, they were really good in that beer. Mm-hmm. They were really good. But I don't say always, but if I have sausage or if I have brats or something like that, I like to put a good beer in there and just let them cook, just let them simmer in that beer.
Yeah. Now, you usually use an amber.
I was just going
to
say.
I almost always use an amber if I have a choice. I like it, and then the amber that you got that I put in there today was really good, too.
Yeah, the Abita Amber?
Yeah, that was really good.
Well, that's because it's from Louisiana.
Well, I was thinking, they use...
I can't even argue with you there. I mean, Louisiana cuisine.
And when I bit into it today, and it just... That juice, oh, man, it was great.
Oh, but I know you usually put them in the beer, and you put them on a little low heat, or mid-heat, around 4.5.
Skillet simmer.
Yeah.
It's about 15 minutes cooking, but 5 minutes on each side, and I turn them twice.
And you just let the beer evaporate until it's almost completely gone, and then you'll pull the sausage out.
And I don't put any seasonings in it. It's nothing but the seasoning that's in the sausage and the beer. That's it.
Well, beer rots, man.
Exactly.
You need to highlight the part of it that's supposed to be there, the beer.
It gets the flavor in there. It gets that little... I've had the brats, and it's amazing to me how I don't really love the taste of beer, but, man, is it good for cooking.
Yeah.
And for some reason, it is a whole other story when you cook with it. It's suddenly tasty as hell.
Like the chorizo you brought. I cooked those in beer. Mm-hmm. And, when I was in the military, I had chorizo, and it was good. I loved it. But when I cooked it that night, because I had Amberbach then, and I cooked it in that Amberbach, man, it just brought out that flavor for me. It just reminded me of my time in the Army.
All right, then I've got something we got to try next weekend, and we can talk about it. I've seen that now they're selling chorizo instead of in the sausage links.
Uh-huh.
They started selling it in the kind of like the Jimmy Dean style.
Mm-hmm.
And that would really soak up that beer. So I'll buy a pack.
Yeah, I don't know, but I've never done the ground sausage in the beer.
But it got it set like the way you do the patties, sausage patties. You want to give it, we can test it.
Yeah.
Let people know how to
turn it. I've done sausage patty, but it was ground fresh. It wasn't pre-patty.
Yeah, yeah.
I just made basically a burger.
Yeah, these are the ground, sort of like what I put in the burgers.
Yeah, it's like that, but it's chorizo. You want to give it a shot?
Hell
yeah. All right, we'll come back. This time we'll be able to see how that one rolls out.
All right. Q? All right.
Yep.
You had that back.
All
right. In honor of Black Panther.
There you go.
Rolling the big black die.
Have fun with that.
Hey, fumbling.
Favorite sci-fi movies.
We burned Duty's favorite movies.
I know. Maybe eight is a weight.
Now we're gonna have to get into the weird stuff after a while.
All right, so go ahead. Since you rolled it, start us off.
Oh man, that's not fair. Okay, let me think of a sci-fi movie. Oh no, that was an asshole answer. I was about to be a jerk.
Okay.
That's more of a comedy. You know what? When it goes back to the sci-fi movie that really first got me into it, I'm going to give, I hate it because it's so stock, but it was the reason it got me in. Original, good Star Wars was the sci-fi movie that introduced me to sci-fi.
Okay.
Prior to that, no love for sci-fi. I actually would not watch it. That was what got me into it. The epic, the story, the incredible special effects for that time.
Cool.
Yeah.
Damien?
Well, I was contemplating Star Wars, but that would have been a canned answer for me because
yeah.
I'm a Star Wars fanatic.
Yeah.
So I was just like, my favorite all time is actually Star Wars, but the one that really gets me excited was Alien.
All
right. Alien was... Because, like, Star Wars is a massive story. It's you know, it's
like a good book on
right,
screen.
Right. It's like a good book. Alien scared the bejesus out of me. without doubt, hands down, that's my favorite.
Every time you got heartburn, you got a little concerned. It's like.
Dude, I mean, an alien comes out of your chest.
And people didn't seem to be able to tell that it was there until the last minute. That's the creepy part.
Yeah,
the idea, I had nightmares of waking up. I'm sorry to jump back in, but,
no,
but I've had the nightmare where in the nightmare, I open my eyes and I see a face hugger dead or gone. I'm like,
which is exactly what it wants you to do.
That's the scariest part, is seeing a face hugger and going, oh, God, no.
Zeno?
Ah, shoot.
We didn't leave
there
nothing.
There are so many sci-fi movies that I really love. And honestly, my answer would probably change day to day. Because, but recently we rewatched Blade Runner.
Mm-hmm.
And I do love the gothic sci-fi feel, you know. And it definitely pulled that off, and it was a wonderful movie. And it even, after rewatching it, it made me that much more disappointed that they're probably going to ruin it with a with a sequel. But hopefully the sequel will be good. The original, awesome, especially the final cut that was recently done.
So good.
They did such a good job on recutting it, and Ridley Scott came and redid it, and it just
brought his vision even better.
Cyberpunk.
That is the movie that I figured you would choose.
Yeah,
because that the reason being is because Blade Runner is not just a sci-fi movie, but it's an action, it's a drama, it's a sci-fi, it's a cop
it
movie.
Covers so many kinds of aspects,
and it's just a plethora of emotions in that movie.
I'm gonna coin the phrase, put together the word cyberpunk noir. That is really, to me, covers it.
Well,
because it's got the noir, but it's got the cyberpunk, man.
And the cyberpunk and gothic sort of go along together anyway. You know, I like the gothic feel. I like cyberpunk stuff. And, you know, I'm big in the noir. So
I know. So, like, I admit it's an excellent choice. Now, just to give an honorable mention, I really, because I was wrestling with it in Star Wars, I can't be the only person that goes, man, the original RoboCop. Like, the original RoboCop was really something to me, and
I
thought one of us was going to throw it out.
RoboCop is being awesome. I rewatched it not that long ago, and it was such a level of cheese that it was hard for me to rewatch. Where Blade Runner sort of continues to be good.
It stands the test of time. I'll give that to Blade Runner.
I don't think RoboCop stood the test of time. You know, Star Wars stands the test of time.
Alien
stands the test of time.
But you see, those are all serious movies in their own way, whereas RoboCop is cheese.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I put Blade Runner in the same category as Clockwork Orange.
Oh, that's...
You know, that's...
Oh, that movie was disturbing when I rewatched it. Oh, man, I forgot how disturbing
so
it was
disturbing.
Until I
so
went
disturbing.
Back and went like, whoa.
But, I mean, you know, that type of movie is what stands the test of time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, RoboCop, I loved it. It was a great movie. It's cheesy as fuck, but I loved it. You know, it's just like, I mean, I like Predator 2 with Danny Glover, but it's a cheesy
movie. I mean, the robot's normally not the good guy, but, like, this was a movie where you
were
rooting
honestly,
for the cyborg.
I almost went with the original Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, but it wasn't technically a movie. It was a miniseries type thing because there was three of them.
That almost falls more into pure space, too.
And it was also a really comedy as well.
Yeah.
So,
but, I mean, you know, I'd allow it.
But I think Blade Runner's, you know, like I said, is where I'm sticking with that. So I think we Blade have a good Runner. Collection here and a good.
Yeah, I mean, none of us threw out any cheesy ass movies.
Plus, you know, like I said, eventually we're going to do specifically space, and you know you're going to want to have that locked down for space.
Well, yeah. Oh, I've already got that.
And like, if to you me, steal
it, if you steal it. Uh-oh. Before I get to say it, I will shoot you in the pinky toe.
Well, see, here's my favorite.
Oh, God. Wait, we can't be thinking of.
I know what my favorite space movie is going to
be. Oh.
I hope we don't roll it out because I think we're all on the same page. All
right, so let's move on to the next.
Wait. No. Y'all might have a different one for me because we. Yeah.
Well, we'll talk about it later.
Yeah. We'll.
That's going to be a good one.
Yeah. Four. LARPing.
Ah, wow. I don't know a lot about LARPing.
I know a bit about it. We mainly put this one on here to annoy Zeno, because of his interesting feelings toward LARPing.
Mm. Well, I dated this girl once. She was a LARPer.
You love the elf ears and you know it.
I know. I do. But...
Let's explain a little bit. Not everybody, because this is kind of almost fringe.
LARPing is a live action role playing, so it's basically where you're if you're familiar with D&D and that type of role playing, this is very similar to that, except you go and you actually reenact alongside of it. A lot of people will have LARPing conventions at campsites and stuff like that, some big open area where they can. Put up props and use large foam swords and sandbags as fireballs and stuff like that. So, I have nothing against LARPing really. Like, it's one of those things that is fun to make fun of, but it's not really a bad thing. It's sort of neat, you know. I mean, if you talk bad about LARPers, you'd have to talk bad about reenactors and. All kinds of other things. So.
And things like the SCA. The SCA is kind of cool. I've actually seen a couple of those matches. That stuff's kind of awesome.
And I've seen some really neat LARPing. I mean, the Coast Con used to do a Vampire the Masquerade LARP down there.
That's what I was about to talk
And it was
about.
Pretty neat. But I've also seen some really, really, like, scarily sad LARPing as well. You know,
Well, there's the thing that I was going to talk about, because I've actually been to a few LARPs, and what I'll say is that LARPing is very different depending on what group. For example, Mind's Eye Theater, or basically the basis for the World of Darkness, vampire LARPing, was actually just almost like really cool acting, you know, because it's set in a modern setting, people are in character, but for the most part, it was really cool. Yeah. I actually was watching it, and I was like, these guys, this is kind of awesome. I have seen a little bit of the, like, you've seen YouTube videos of some of the running around in the woods and dressed up as a wizard, yelling fireball 19 times as you throw beanbags at people.
Magic missile. Oh, I'm out of mana.
And it basically comes down to the people. Some people get in there, they're there to have fun. Some people get a little obsessive with it. But yeah. I've seen both good and bad, and people, like anything in real life, just like we said about, like, even in politics, people tend to pick the worst examples and judge the whole group based on it.
Well, yeah,
people look at the worst of LARPing and laugh at it. They do the same thing with furries and other stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yet there's some really cool LARPing out there.
Yeah. That's why I say they're fun to make fun of, is because you do have those extremes that are just... So they're almost too easy.
I've seen it. But you know what though? I'm not gonna hate on anybody. Whatever your game love is, go for it. But I gotta lie. I can't do fantasy. I can do World of Darkness, but I can't do fantasy. The fantasy LARPing, I admit, I just can't get into it enough.
Yeah, I mean, to each their own and everything. But yeah.
I saw some King Arthur esque LARPing, and it was horrid because everybody was trying to speak in English accents.
Yeah. You'll get some of that at the SCC or S.
Some people show to kick up the kick butt, but some people show up to sit around and go, Paige, bring me my mead. And you're like,
well, this one that it was actually set in like a medieval setting, medieval town. They had a blacksmith, they had a tavern, you know. I mean, it was set up really, really nice.
Oh, yeah.
And when I went there, I was in the mood, man, because, you know, there was no electricity, it was all awesome. And then I heard people speaking, and it just ruined the whole effect for me, you know.
I also had a bad experience at one of the reenactment SCC type events where I may have had a little too much to drink, and
it was your fault. I can already tell this, but go ahead.
And at some point, I ended up naked on the interstate. So
I don't think that has anything to do with it being their fault. That really sounds like that's all you.
Okay, oh, Google.
No, it was definitely my fault. But it's still, you know, when I think about LARPing, it still brings that bad memory. Okay, Google, roll a d20.
Coming right up. It's a 16.
We actually got the sound
it back.
Again.
They brought it back. They must have listened.
Con etiquette. Since we are going to the Mississippi Con coming up, we did put this on here because there was a lot of questions of etiquette at the last con we
all
went
my fault.
To. Not all you. There was other people who definitely did not show the proper etiquette at a con. But, and I mean, con etiquette isn't much different than just everyday life etiquette. It's just people sometimes, for some reason, think that they're at a con, they can show off. And
my mistake was that I assumed that everybody shows up in a costume, so they're there to be seen.
Mm-hmm.
So I was walking around filming people in their costumes. I had a camera. And my assumption, and I got told, you might want to ask it because some of these people do this for money. You know, it's a business to them, and you know. So I said, okay. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I told you, it's etiquette. It's also etiquette to ask. I mean, nobody is hardly going to tell you no, you know.
No turndowns.
But if, you know, and we want to show that we are taking everything seriously and being, and so you don't want to just go up there and start doing it without asking, because it's etiquette. You know, it's a nice thing to do. And like I said, and most people are more than happy. And honestly, when we ask, we get a lot more out of them anyway, because they'll especially being that we carry around a video camera when we go, so they'll do a lot of poses and action and stuff like that. So.
Oh yeah, but that's how I got that awesome, because I literally just walked up and said, "I want you guys to fight," and they're like, They looked at the camera and said, "All right," and they said, "You know, you got Obi-Wan versus like." The new Darth guy.
Well, I mean, I saw you had caught another good one while I was away at the last con where the, it was Sub-Zero.
Oh, yeah, Sub-Zero and Jade.
And when he's standing up there posing, he's doing the Mortal Kombat where they stand still and sort of move back and forth. I mean, he was doing it perfectly, just like the guy in the game. And I was just like, oh, that's awesome, you know.
So, I mean, you just got to, like, you know, be aware when you go to these cons that not, you know, you don't want to just run up in everyone's face and start taking pictures. Mm-hmm. I mean, we didn't do anything too bad. Like, we weren't just shoving microphones in faces, at least.
Well, no. And I mean, all it was, you know, you were scanning the place and saw some people that passed in front of you and you sort of lingered on them. And that's what I was just saying, you know.
That's why I started walking with the camera down when we were walking around so they wouldn't think they were being filmed when they weren't. So it's like. Because, boy, those heads pop up when they saw that camera. Everybody's like, huh? What's he doing? It's like, no, I'm not. Not you. Sorry.
You know, the only other problem I see is people, when somebody is talking to somebody or somebody else is taking a picture, people will walk in front of you and stuff like that, which, you know, watch where you're going. When you know, there are a lot of people taking pictures. There are a lot of people, you know, trying to pull off a scene or whatever. So just keep your eyes open when you're at a con and don't just walk right in front of somebody who has a camera. It's
especially if there's a guy standing over the freaking mic. I mean, I had to glare one dude down. You probably saw it. I probably distracted you because he's up here interviewing the guy. And somebody just starts walking up and gets ready to walk into the camera. And I literally like went.
Yeah.
And I'm like, go around.
Well,
like,
the thing is there was, you know, and we were making sure to be accurate as well as we made sure not to clog up an entire pathway. We left plenty of space so that people could move through.
Yeah, we're behind whenever we could behind the desk so that it was like there was plenty of room.
Because that was another thing I noticed with some of the other people that were taking pictures is they'd stop in the middle of the aisle and block off the entire aisle. And that's not right either, you know. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, if you take it off to the side and you're doing your thing and you're not out in the middle of people's way, why are you going to walk through there? That makes no sense.
I was going to trip that one dude, though, and we kept going. I was like, we about to have some funniest home videos. I was going to be like, boom, and then just it'd have you put, like, edit in, like, card etiquette.
Oh.
But all in all, you guys did a good job at the con.
Oh, yeah, no, we had a blast. And like I said, we pointed out a couple of bad apples. Most everybody is very kind and very etiquette. There's very few people that did not follow con etiquette. So,
yeah, and a lot of them didn't give us a lot of trouble. I mean, most of the folks, like you said, were willing to talk to you. Nobody was like, give me $20. Well, nobody else. Like, maybe one person. I'm not going to throw out a name. He knows who he is.
But no.
Well, I mean, you know, when you don't have anything else going for you.
You know, it's not that hard to figure out if they go look at our videos and look at who was there, so we ought to stop. Because you can almost go down to... We talk to so many people, you can almost do process of elimination and figure out who the one person is.
So anyway, on that note, I think that pretty much ties us up on our four subjects. Hey guys, thanks for watching this episode. Be sure to like, subscribe, and down below we have a description with all of our social media. Check that out. You can check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Patreon, Google+. All the links are down there. You can see some behind-the-scenes stuff, as well as, you know, just whenever we're posting something, we always post to those medias as well. Also, you can look over to the side here, and we'll have some links to some other videos you might want to check out, as well as below you'll see the Dice Junkies icon where you can click to subscribe. Thanks for watching. Have a good day. All right.